Today, what I wanted to do was to walk you through the application of mindful leadership in organizations, in companies, and some of the experiences I had, some of the things I learned, and share some of those things. And after that, so I think we have about 25 minutes, 30 minutes around. Afterwards, we'll do some Q&A, so there might be a lot of questions, and hopefully I can answer most of them.
Could you speak up a bit? Mm-hmm.
Good. Okay, so first of all, so who am I? So my name is Rainer, as Daniel mentioned. And in terms of locations, I definitely traveled the world in some instances. I grew up in middle part of Germany, in, to be precise, in Hesse. And then I grew up there the first 20 plus years. In the mid 90s, I studied computer science. I thought, let's go where the action is. And the action at that point was in the Silicon Valley, in California, in the San Francisco Bay Area. I thought, oh, this is kind of cool, let's go there. And actually, while I was wrapping up my studies here, there was a basically internship type of thing, and I went there, and actually with my wife Bettina, she's also sitting here. At that point we weren't married, by the way, but we were in California and the sun was shining, and I actually saw it was shining every day, and that was something I said, wow, this is cool, let's stay here, right, and see what happens. We didn't really have plans on in terms of how long we would be there, but we always said something like, as long as it makes sense. And actually then I stayed there about 20 years until there was some impulse coming up, going to Berlin. And I, at this point, still don't know why this impulse came, but somehow it was there, and you could see there was all of the sudden opportunities came up. And then Zalando actually approached me and ask whether I can help to build up some of their technology, particularly around search, personalization, and that was one of my areas of expertise. And I said, oh, this is kind of cool, let's do it. Obviously, this was a major change, so to speak. At that point, family, two kids, they were 11 and 15, I think, if I recall, roughly, so teenagers. Grown up in California, now come to Germany, so that was fun. But nevertheless, the past decades, basically, I played several roles in various capacities. On one side, as an engineer, scientist, but also in terms of all kind of other roles, as musician, but then in the family, husband, father, right, all kind of different roles, and most of the time, many of them at once. What I realized in now going to this topic, in my professional life, I'm dealing with technology, particularly when it gets really complicated in terms of bringing engineering and science, computer science together. That was really my passion, and really going deep into science and figuring out how to actually make it work. And then later on, I moved more and more towards leadership, as I've seen that I can actually multiply what I'm doing if I have a small team. So this is how I started out. And then over the years, the teams, they got bigger and bigger and bigger and more responsibility. But at the end of the day, the task was kind of similar. It was basically building something up and grow it, make it large. And so that is on one side the role in terms of technology leadership. At this point, I actually joined a startup. Unar is the name, and maybe some of you heard it. It's kind of cool. We actually started even last year, but this year was really when there was a lot of energy moving in. And we actually, originally the company is in Frankfurt, moved here to Berlin.
Could you please speak up a little
Yeah, I'll try my best. But so basically what Yuna is doing, we have a nice app for loyalty, managing your loyalty cards. So it's fun, and there's, again, there's a lot of technology involved, again, building up teams, similar thing. But now actually going to, so what about mindfulness, or in general, I talk about mindfulness in leadership. How is that, what's the connection there? And for me, there were really profound moment, probably around 2015, when something basically happened to me, in a sense that I was working hard, obviously, all the time, particularly Silicon Valley, you work a lot. At some time, you feel the stress symptoms, and that's usually when it comes to you, right? The more and more stress is building up. There was no tools at this point that I knew about. But at work, they offered something called MBSR, Mindfulness-Based Stress Reduction. So this was in 2014-15, roughly, when companies there in the Valley already had programs and tools in place, because they know there's a lot of stress, let's do something. And this is where my journey started. I had some really, at that point, first experience in meditation. So some of you have meditated maybe just a few minutes ago for the first time. This happened to me probably in 2014-15, roughly, right? And something over the next few weeks there really profoundly deep happened when I had some experiences. I said, what's going on? And I couldn't really make sense out of it, but I was trying to get deeper and deeper to this. But I always felt that when applying mindfulness, that the positive effects, getting calmer and calmer, and you could see over the time, it was really good for me, primarily in the first place, a tool for managing stress. So I felt, oh, this is great. Now I can work even more, right? Get more stuff done, because I like to get a lot of stuff done. But then obviously there's always some things to find some balance. Anyhow, so what I realized, however, and that when it gets really interesting, is mindfulness, first I looked at it primarily for me as a tool to manage stress, to basically become more focused. And I looked at the positive aspects of mindfulness on a personal level. But then I realized, actually, when I was at work, I looked at all the, in quotes, the chaos happening there, particularly in larger organizations. And I thought, well, those companies, those organizations I'm working in, they could actually benefit from mindfulness at work. Why is nobody doing it? What's going on? And then over, this was in the early, this was 2015-16, still in California. At that point, it was, I mean, some companies applied it, but it wasn't that common. Nowadays, actually, as you've noticed, and some of you already are informed around some of the studies possibly that they have done, particularly in SAP, they really now, they have numbers there. What they're showing is mindfulness at work is actually a positive investment in terms of the ROI, what you get back. It's actually 200% or even plus, right? So all of a sudden the organization realized, oh, this is cool, this is a big deal, we actually get something back. And in addition, of course, employees becoming more happy, they're less sick. So there's all kind of stuff that comes out of these studies. And so the hypothesis really is, when I use the term conscious business is a business that tries to have some really sustainability and long-term type of benefit that it can bring value on this planet. And developing into a conscious business nowadays, and I wrote some articles as well on this on my blog. I think it's not like a nice to have thing anymore. It's really, I call it a matter of evolve or die in the next few years. So I make a really strong statement here, because I think what's going to happen, the key talent, particularly I speak for the technology area, the key talent goes there where they feel they can make the best impact, right? But there has to be some purpose and some meaning in there. And so if you work just for a company that is doing something that is overall not sustainable, or something that is not beneficial to the overall planet, very quickly you have a disadvantage compared to a company who is doing something more sustainable. So I think that's the hypothesis. The question is now, how to go towards becoming a more conscious business. And so the mindfulness itself, therefore, is, I think, is not the end goal. Mindfulness is basically a foundation, but what you're really looking for is the effects of what mindfulness brings towards the business. It's basically better collaboration. If mindfulness at work, you will have a much nicer collaboration with your coworkers, less friction, less politics. It's basically everything becomes more pleasant to be at. And I think at the end of the day, if you achieve this type of working atmosphere and then people really focusing on customer problems, solving customer problems, I think this is where the impact comes. So it's not mindfulness for the mindfulness sake, but it's really for what can be done with it. So I think there is a few sections I want to touch through. There's a lot of different topics. I want to walk you through a few scenarios. So first of all, the question comes up in terms of what is the overarching idea, right? The overarching idea around mindfulness, and what I really then mean, because the term is very broad and can mean a lot of different things, I really am talking about present awareness. Present awareness is what you just did before when we started in a meditation, which is be there in the current moment, fully. Be there fully in the current moment. And at the end of the day, if you can increase present awareness in organization, people being more present, what's happening is all those benefits that I was showing earlier of mindfulness. So mindfulness is a tool or mechanism to generate or deepen this present awareness and elevate it. But then once you have it, then good stuff happens in the organization. But what you have to do is, so the organization usually has, there is on one side leaders and there's employees. It's a typical organizational setup. And what we have to do therefore is somehow we have to start. And you can start obviously by tackling the whole company. Let's make sure people become more mindful, right? Let's do all of them. That would be perfect. There's different ways to tackle it, right? I think I thought about top down. Top down means you look at the top, right, where the leaders are, the senior management team. If they become more mindful, right, that would be one, and then mindfulness or present awareness basically trickles down to the next layer and so on in a could be big hierarchy. So if you use, for instance, Zalando as an example with 10,000 plus employees, you can imagine there is a lot of leaders in the organization embedded, and so there has to, a lot of mindfulness has to trickle down until it reaches everywhere. On the other hand, you can say, oh, let's start with every employee. So let's say, like when I worked at Yahoo, they had these mindfulness-based programs. Let's basically see if we can have a program for every employee, and then they we start here, and that's also a way where you can get very broad basically coverage. And then there's other approaches, I call them hybrid, where you do a little bit on the top, a little bit from below, and those are all possible things. But what I was focusing on here in mindfulness leadership principles is focus on the top and then let it spread down, because I felt in my experience this is a more effective way, and I'll provide some examples. There's a quick question.
Yes, just if you speak directly to me, I can about hear you.
Yeah.
The moment you turn
you speak, it's hard, yeah.
Maybe,
yeah. So I'll try to speak up more, but obviously I have to turn around. Maybe microphone could have helped, but yeah, sorry. We'll see. Good. Good. Okay, let's continue. When I was talking about the top-down approach, meaning leadership, what you will notice in different companies is that they have something called leadership principles. So leadership principles are good practices that the company comes up with as part of the culture of a company. So it's more like a guidance, because it's not that you can manage every leader and tell them exactly this is what you have to do here and here. There's always situations, so you set up some principles. And then many companies are doing this, and I'm one of the most popular ones is from Amazon, so you can actually look it up on their website. And I don't want to go deep into the into them, but if you read through some of them, hire and develop the best, insist on highest standards, frugality, ownership, and so on. This all looks like very good, right? Very simple, intuitive, if you read it. And this is a way for providing guidance to the leaders. But there is a big problem with this approach. And the problem is, at the end of the day, if those leadership principles are not applied in a mindful way, they can lead really into disaster, into a really toxic work environment. If you actually Google for Amazon leadership principles and read some news articles and put the word toxic in there, right, you can find some news articles and you say, oh my goodness, what's going on at Amazon? And certainly it doesn't mean that everywhere, Amazon is a huge company, that's everywhere that bad, but you can see what can happen. I mean, the leader is applying these principles, but you can apply them in different ways, right? And so that is the problem when you have these principles. So what I thought about it in the following was that, what can we do? Because companies have these leadership principles, and we don't want to remove them, because every company has some thoughts on how leaders should behave. But I thought, well, if we say something like some of these principles, let me actually pick one here. Where was it? Oh, here it was. Yeah, one ahead here. So let's say I pick ownership, right? Let's say I pick ownership. Isn't there something that I can provide a little bit more guidance when I said ownership? What does this mean, right? How should I look at ownership? Ownership, as you know, the ego, this is where your ego can come in, could become relatively quickly, ownership could become toxic, right? Could become something where a lot of negative feelings could come up. If you're so obsessed with ownership, think about what you would do with your colleague, right? If you think this is your group, this is my department, what is this guy doing here, right? You should stay here, right? So you can very quickly, you can see these turf, I call them turf wars, coming up with ownership. So could we give them some guidance on what to do? And this when I published what I call mindfulness leadership principles. They are actually on my blog. And I think it's probably about 2 years ago or sometimes when I did this. But the idea was, in general, keep it very simple, intuitive, and use them really as an underlying foundation. So don't replace any leadership principles, like in case Amazon's. They can keep whatever they have, but use these in addition to tell when they read about ownership, how to think about ownership. So to give them extra impulses for this. And then what I did was actually, it was not just that I was smoking something and then basically writing up these principles. Then I said, actually, here, look, let's try this out at Zalando. Let's see what we can do. And so I had my leadership team assembled at that point. I shared the document. They were looking at it. And there was good feedback. And I think what I wanted to do was now very quickly walk you through them, just that you get a sense of what they are. Because in the interest of time, obviously, we can't cover everything in very details. But at least you get a glimpse of it. And then I tell you also what the feedback was from my leadership team at this point. So first one is, be mindful in all your thoughts, words, and action. This is the foundation one, that's why it's number one. It's very easy to understand, right? If I tell you, oh yeah, this is be mindful in everything you do and think. Also, it's so intuitive, it's the hardest to follow, right? And what it requires is systematic training of your mind. And some of you may have started already training your mind, and so they probably then know what I'm talking about. But if I want to go in a little bit deeper on this topic, it's one of the hardest things you can actually do, in my experience. That's why this one is so important, but also so hard. So the second one is around the idea of mistakes. That's a very important one. Allow yourself and others to make mistakes and learn from them. If you have an environment where you can make mistakes at work, this already gives you a safety net. And what it will help is, when you have this environment, you build up also trust, right? You try out things, and this is actually how you learn. You try out things, you fail, you learn, you get better. And I think this is a really underlying, cushion. If you try to avoid mistakes by trying to be perfect, usually what this means is it will lead to mediocre results. So make mistakes, make many of them, fail, learn, and do it again. The third one is staying present. This is what I said at the beginning, present awareness, stay present in all your interactions. That means, for instance, how can you, it's very simple examples, active listening. Go in a meeting and try to stay present. That means actually listen to what the other person is saying, not already thinking in your head your reply while the other person is talking. So just think about being present and listening. Right? This is a good example of what you can do. The fourth one, very important, is also the always questions your thoughts. That's a very important one, and assumptions, whether you can absolutely be sure they are true. And I've seen this a lot in leaders that I was working with. They came to me, they were so hectic, and oh my goodness, the world is going to end, something like this, and they had an idea why the world is going to end or whatever bad stuff is going to happen. And then I looked at them and said, so can you absolutely be sure this is true, 100%? And just this question alone, just asking, is it 100, can you absolutely be sure? And to be honest, most time they couldn't. So it was just something they made up in their mind. So it's always challenge what you think, because in most of the cases, it's actually not true. The next one is don't judge, just observe. Once you start judging, you're not open anymore. You basically have something built up, a thought in your mind that is now static. And then if an event comes up, you will be observing this event, not really the way it is, but you have your own already opinion. So let's an example in your group, for instance. Someone did something that wasn't that great, right? And you weren't happy about it. And you think this is a lazy person, right? A week later, something else happens. You observe the person may not be even lazy, but you still have this thing in your mind, oh, this could be a lazy person. And so you judge, right? And then the situation is changing. So that's one of the other ones. Choose a positive attitude, also very important, stay positive. Accept change. Change is happening all the time. You can't prevent it from happening. And why even worry about it? It just happens. Particularly in organizations, when change is there really on a daily basis. Do not get too attached to the outcome. People get obsessed on goals. I've seen that in companies happening all the time. There's this big goal, you have to reach this goal, right? And then everything left or right will be ignored, right? And that's another way when you have these principles, customer obsession, and there is this goal, and then you may do things, if you look back and reflect, may not be actually the most beneficial thing to do, right? If you all of a sudden ignore people or you just elbow right, left and right, and just let the ego again creep in. So, and that's my next thing, watch out for your ego. Ego is there, it will come. And if you're getting more mindful, you can actually observe the ego when it comes. And you can then have the possibility to actually react differently. But if you're caught up in your ego, that means usually you don't have a choice and you do things that later on you think, what the heck did I just do? So keep an eye on it. In business, it's not that you can't get, I think ego actually is there's a good thing to it as well. So I'm not saying it's a bad thing, it just happens. But you may need some ego here and there. So it's, I call this ego calibration. It's a difficult topic, but it's something to keep an eye out, because a lot of the problems are related to this. Lead through inspiration, not control, is another thing. Don't try to micromanage your teams. Try to help them, give them inspiration and give them a purpose, and they will basically do what they need to do. For me, the pillars are purpose, mastery, autonomy. It's not something new I invented. It's out there, and it's a relatively simple thing. If the purpose is clear, the people have autonomy, they know what to do, they figure it out, right? So don't get in their way and try to micromanage, but let them, give them inspiration. The rest happens automatically. Be humble, that's another one. I think if I've observed here, the danger in here is if you start, the ego comes out and you start boasting with all your successes, there it has some problems with it. I think so stop basically comparing yourself. It's just be humble, observe things as they are again, and let others basically have some opinions. And this one, recognize, be thankful. This is an important one. Every day at work, there's little things happening, and we take those for granted. But actually, you can actually be happy if you think about, if you have employees, just the fact that they show up in the morning is actually something that is a good thing. And if they do little things, just keep an eye out and basically recognize them. Good, expect nothing, accept anything, grow and teach others to become mindful leaders. That's really the last one. Once you look at these principles and you live them, you come to a stage where you can actually teach it, right? So at some point I felt I can actually teach them, and then the purpose really becomes teach others to become mindful leaders. And then this is the multiplier effect. This is the multiplication effect. Good, so I think I walked you quickly through them. Now the feedback from my leadership team. What did they say, right? I think even Volker was in this meeting, if I recall, right? So they said, oh, sounds cool, sounds interesting, right? Perfect, very intuitive, simple. But the big thing was really about, that leaders may not be able to apply these mindful leadership principles. They look so simple, but if there is a principle there, be present in every present awareness in everything you do, and you're not trained to do this, what do you do, right? So, and that was the big insight for me, that if I can't support these leaders really, if I want them to live mindfulness leadership principles, they have to train their mind. That's really, and that is a motivation that it needs to be intrinsic in the person, and it requires a lot of commitment. If some of you obviously are interested in the topic of mindfulness, you know it requires a deep intrinsic motivation to do this. So there are some prerequisites here. At the end, it boils down to mindfulness training, and it also requires what I call consciousness engineering. And I'll talk a little bit about this later. But as you know, time is always tight, so I need to speed up a little bit. So in larger organizations like Zalando, the challenges primarily were that buy-in from senior management is always something that you have to have, otherwise you're not going to make it in terms of any changes in the company. There's a lot of convoluted processes internally, politics, battling. And then even if you do something in your own organization, then there is another organization that's doing something completely different. What do you do, right? So it's really hard in large organization. That was the outcome. Startups is a different game. I'm actually now in a startup, and that was actually for me one of the motivations to be in a startup. Say, oh, this is a smaller company. That might, maybe some of those things are easier to do. So I think the approach here is really alignment in the senior management team around the topic on values, for instance, is a good starting point, but also around how we want to lead, how we want to basically apply these values in practice. So senior management buy-in, but then also in combination, the hybrid approach, provide training opportunities for those who are interested to learn more. What can be, there's a lot of options available, and obviously Daniel and the team can talk more about this, what kind of things exist, but that's usually a good way to go. So best practices on the topic is use this hybrid approach. I said at the beginning you can tackle everything at once, but usually that's not focused enough. Usually that's why I recommend try a top-down approach. Start with the leaders, because if a leader is doing this, it will trickle into the organization, but also complement it with broader mindfulness-based programs and ideas in the company. And I think the key thing obviously is the leaders need to be ready for this, right? If you have leaders, they're not ready, it's not going to happen. Good, so big picture. So I have a few minutes left only. I need to rush through, unfortunately. I think the, look at the bigger picture, why mindfulness in companies? The bigger picture on these leadership principles is to really enhance the culture and the work environment of a organization, to raise the present awareness in the organization. And if you do this, then this company, this organization now becomes more what I call conscious, more higher level of consciousness in this field. And if this happens obviously in one company, but it can happen in many, many companies across the world. And this is really the interesting part, that it will help in general on a bigger picture. And the goal here really is to increase consciousness, level of consciousness on the whole planet. So I'm like to think big, not just small, think big. So for that reason, I created two challenges. The one is called Change 1 Billion Thoughts. It's on Instagram, and this is really a goal. So my goal is I change 1 billion thoughts, right? This sounds big, but I think it's doable. I actually started maybe a year ago, or I don't know, I forgot, something like this. And it actually works. Obviously, it's hard to measure. But for me, it's more the spirit of the idea. It's not about that I have to count every thought and have this exact measurement. It's more that I can see, I can, just by being here, I may send some impulses that go through. So it's really, the key thing is, the reason why I'm so motivated in the topic is, as I'm deep in technology, that's what I said at the beginning, I know that the current technology growth rate is at an exponential rate. It will growing. Artificial intelligence, which is one of my fields of expertise, is basically raising up like this. And you can imagine if the technology becomes more and more powerful, and if the consciousness level of humans remains flat, or maybe grows too slow, we may have a problem. That's what I'm thinking, right? So the question, however, is between this race, between consciousness and technology, who's going to win? Nobody knows. But I think if we can make an impact here by increasing present awareness in companies, and particularly for me in the leaders, right, there is a chance that this has a significant growth in global consciousness. So that's, I think, the idea where that got me motivated. So looking at the big pictures. So 2 minutes to wrap up. Basically, what I'm planning coming up, so a little bit of mini advertising to really do this. I said I need to work with leaders and really help them to come up to this next level of helping to increase present awareness. So I thought, oh, why not actually setting up a seminar, workshop? And because you have to spend and invest some time to do it, otherwise it's not going to happen, right? And so I thought about, obviously based on my experience, on a program that I thought can be done in 2 days over a weekend, so Friday evening to Sunday. And I actually thought about it, oh, let's do it this fall. So the question is where would do it? It's actually 2 hours here from Berlin. It's in it's called Ponsdorf. I never heard about this place, but intuitively when I was at the seminar in Munich, the owner of this place, I got connected, and I was wondering, so we had some discussion, and then I sometimes thought, so the discussion came, oh, I have this nice place for seminars. I said, what, seminars? I said, oh, this could be cool. So we exchanged, basically connected, and I thought this is a perfect place to do the seminar. And I mean, look at this environment. So you can see if you actually spend a weekend there, I think this is a perfect setup where you can actually work on increasing your present awareness, right? And your leadership level and effectiveness. So I thought this is great, let's do it. There will be certain topics. Today I could just give you a teaser of some of them, but there is lots to cover. On one side, I think the combination of hands-on mindfulness training, this is the foundation for everything. However, consciousness engineering is a key part. Topics like letting go of your limiting thoughts, old belief, reactive patterns, learn new about new models of reality, implement new systems for leadership growth, and ongoing consciousness elevation. So those are things I think that would be very relevant to reach this level of mindful leadership. I call it mindful leadership mindset, and really build it out. So I think that's the idea. So obviously, at this point, this is a very early idea. So I had this idea, impulse, let's do it. Details to follow, if you're interested, there is my email. Send me email, contact me, I'll send you more details. For now, this will be a very small group. I'm planning there will be 12 people, not more, not less. It will be exactly 12 people, 12 slots, and that's it. So, but I'm planning somehow fall, right? October maybe, we'll see how it goes. Good, so with that said, I'm opening up the time for now for questions, right?